Ann Wells, Advanced Planning Manager, and I wanted to make sure to just state some appreciation for you for attending the Affordable Housing Fee Studies public workshop. We really appreciate your input as always, but on this one especially, because we all know that housing is a big need in our area, well, in all of California really, but especially on the South Coast and Goleta, where our land and housing costs are really expensive. And so you may or may not be aware, the city addresses affordable housing needs in a few different ways. And tonight's workshop is addressing certain financial tools to support the development of affordable housing. And so your input is going to be key to the tool that we have that comes out of this process. So again, thank you for attending. And Jay Ritterbeck is the city's project manager, and he will take it from here. Thank you.
Thank you, Anne. So I would also like to introduce our consultant team from Kaiser Marston Associates, our senior principal. That's our main point of contact with KMA is David Dozema. He'll be representing his team, and he'll be giving the majority of the presentation that really gets into the details of the two studies that were done and then the accompanying reports. And those reports are also available and have been for a little over a week on the city's website. So we want to thank David for being here and all the work that he and his team have put in to the project thus far.
Well, thank you, Jay. Good to be here.
So just as a format for this evening's meeting, we'll be going through a little bit of the background and the purpose on why the city has embarked on these studies. And then we'll hand it off to David, who will go through first the non-residential impact fee study, then the residential in lieu fee study, then it'll come back to planning staff, and we'll really discuss what our next steps are going to be and how this project will move forward. We'll do a Q&A at the end, but we also put a Q&A after the non-residential topic has concluded, just to give the opportunity that if there's anybody that's on this meeting specifically for those non-residential impact fee issues, that they have that opportunity to speak then if they didn't want to continue on to the end of the meeting to ask their questions. So we are, I'll be admitting people as they show up as well. So if I get a little distracted, I'm sorry. So thank you. With that, we'll go into a little bit of the background. So the city has had inclusionary ordinance through Title 17, and we've also had housing element policy that has spoken to the collection of in lieu fees or in lieu payments for residential development. And those have been dealt with kind of on a case-by-case basis. There hasn't been a formal program that has been developed and adopted by the city. So we've always, since incorporation, we've been doing these by case by case. And in those instances where there's a duplex up to a quadplex, those automatically will pay an in lieu fee because there's not the opportunity for them to pay or to build. That 20% of four doesn't get you to a whole unit. So they fee out automatically, and single family dwellings are exempt from it, from that inclusionary requirement. So it's really those five or more units that were really affected by our inclusionary policies in the general plan. And then once Title 17 was adopted, really fleshing out what those development standards actually look like. So it gave a little bit more structure to the program. So our in lieu fees are now built in, but we didn't have any real analysis that had been done behind that to really establish a program that developers and citizens would know what was happening before the project came in. So it wasn't always a case by case basis. Similarly, with the non-residential, we had housing element 2.2b that really spoke to just a general term, contributing to affordable housing when a new development would come in. And again, done on a case-by-case basis and has been implemented through the general plan since that general plan was first adopted. But again, no actual program or fee structure had been developed. So those were the purposes behind really going in and doing the necessary analyses and then coming together, putting that all those data together into a report to present to City Council and the Planning Commission for adoption by the City Council. So that's really how we got here. So these studies establish for the non-residential really establish that citywide affordable housing impact fee. And this will be an impact fee rather than an in-lieu fee. So they're really two different types of payments to the city, two different types of fees. So the non-residential impact fee study gets into really establishing that nexus that the city needed to establish those fees. And then the residential in-lieu fee study really does a comparison of, you know, what's normally done, what do adjacent cities do, and what is a reasonable cost for that could be established. And David will get into those a little bit further into this presentation. And from here, I'll hand it off to David. And I believe it's just him for his team. So thank you, David.
Thank you, Jay. And as mentioned, we'll start with the non-residential study and walk through that, and then we'll pause to get questions and comments with regard, hopefully focused on the non-residential first, and then we'll walk through the residential study, and then there'll be another opportunity for questions and comments on that. So the non-residential study has a nexus analysis as part of it that establishes a maximum in terms of what could be legally charged. And then there's a series of additional analyses that can help the city in informing the selection of an appropriate fee level for non-residential. So if Jay, you could move to, or do I have control here? That's fine. So you can keep advancing it for me. So non-residential affordable housing impact fees are designed to mitigate the impacts of new non-residential construction on the need for affordable housing. It's something that's been around since the 1980s. There's about 50 programs statewide. Goleta's Housing Element Policy 2.2b is the only program that we were able to identify within Santa Barbara County. And if we could go to the next slide, this outlines the main feature of that policy is that the city will require new non-residential construction and propose expansion or intensification of existing non-residential development to contribute to providing affordable employee housing. And as Jay mentioned, that's been the policy of the city since 2006. And if you look back to the projects that have been subject to the policy, on an average basis, projects have paid approximately $6 per square foot. The policy itself calls for preparation of a development impact fee study, which is what we've now done. Over the past decade, there's been approximately 1 million square feet of non-residential development of all types. Office and hotel have been the largest categories within that 1 million square feet. But there is a temporary moratorium on new water service that's anticipated to be a limitation on development in the near term. That limitation is implemented by the water district, it's on a year-to-year basis, but is a constraint on development going forward until it's lifted. So the next study, as I said, establishes a maximum or a ceiling on what the city could charge from a legal standpoint. Under the law, you have to show that there's a reasonable relationship between a fee and the impact that fee addresses. And so the nexus study is intended to address that legal standard. If we go to the next slide, The basis for that analysis is that when we construct new non-residential buildings, we're adding jobs, and that those new jobs are at a range of pay levels, including some at lower income levels. And so there's a demand for affordable housing added as part of that new construction and addition of jobs. So the analysis quantifies that and establishes the cost of mitigating that affordable housing impact. And that's what you see here. And these mitigation costs are maximums, right? The city is free to set a fee anywhere below these maximums. And that is typically, in implementing these programs, what jurisdictions do. Virtually every jurisdiction that has a fee goes well below the maximum. In the report itself, we also provide a separate set of findings that reflect mitigation of the impacts that are associated with employees who live in the city of Goleta. And based on the current commute pattern, it's about a 23% share of Goleta employees live in the city of Goleta. So that's an additional piece of information that's in the report. I don't have it on the slide. So if we could go to the next. This next slide provides an estimate of total development costs for non-residential projects. We went through recent and pipeline projects that the city has and developed representative projects in terms of their physical characteristics, floor area ratio, density, construction, and looked at land sales to estimate land costs. So the utility of this information really is about understanding what this fee represents in terms of its impact on the overall cost and budget of a new construction project. And the other utility of this information is that it can help the city in selecting fees and scaling fees by type of project. So take, for example, the warehouse. $215 to $260 per square foot is the estimated development cost for that warehouse, which is about half, in rough terms, what medical office building would take to construct. And so that every dollar of fee to that warehouse is about twice as much of an impact on the project budget, just in percentage terms. So it's helpful just in the concept of scaling fees relative to their impact on a project budget. So if we could go to the next, please. This takes us in the left-hand column, you see those same costs that we saw in the prior slide. And then we then use those that cost information to express potential fee levels as a percentage of those costs. And this is just sort of an illustration of the point earlier that with a warehouse distribution, like with an $8 fee, that $8 fee would represent over 3% of the cost of that project. But for a medical office or shopping center, it's only 1.5% of the cost of the project. So it's that $8 is sort of more of a burden to that warehouse than it would be for the medical office or shopping center, just in terms of percentage impact. So if we could go to the next. Here we're looking at how Goleta's all total fees, so not just affordable housing, and actually affordable housing fees are not included in this slide. So the city of Goleta for a business park use has fees of approximately $22 per square foot is what they equate to. While the city of Santa Barbara has a fee, doesn't have any fees itself, but there's school fees that apply in Santa Barbara, that's $1 per square foot. The county, the Goleta area, has fees that are similar in magnitude to the city itself. Although it's helpful to keep in mind that in the county, there's really, in my understanding, less land use, less land that's available really for commercial development. So that's something to keep in mind in thinking about that county Goleta area. And then we have also the Orcutt area, city of Ventura and city of Santa Maria as comparison points. So just the broad picture here is that the city's fees are kind of on the high end. If we could go to the next. This is the same analysis for hotel, and it's really the same conclusion where the city's current fees are higher when you look compared to other jurisdictions that you might see commercial development in. And we have another bar chart like this on the next slide for retail. And it's the same story where the city's fees, in this case, $69 a square foot for retail, are towards the higher end.
Hey, David.
Yes.
Do you mind if I interject here?
Of course.
I just wanted to note that the city of Santa Barbara fees, they look really low, but they charge developers in different ways than fees. So it's a little bit of apples and oranges when it comes to the city of Santa Barbara comparison. And I forgot to mention that before, but I'll just flag it now.
Okay, good point. All right, so maybe we could move on to the next. So shifting gears here to affordable housing fees. So this is just the affordable housing portion of it. It's not all fees like we were looking at on the prior charts. And as mentioned, there isn't a comparison in terms of a non-residential affordable housing fee nearby. So we're looking to a little bit broader geographic area, to Southern California and Central Coast here. LA has a fee. When they initially adopted it, it was between $3 and $5 a square foot, and it varied by zone. Santa Monica is kind of the high end at $13. And then you can see the other comparisons, 9 for West Hollywood, 5 for Culver City, 4 for Glendale. And then San Diego and the county of San Luis Obispo are kind of the low end of the range at $1 or $2 per square foot. So that just gives you a sense of what other jurisdictions are doing in terms of affordable housing fees. If we could go on. So our recommendation for the city to consider in setting an impact fee level for non-residential is to look at a fee of up to $8 per square foot for most categories of non-residential. And for hotel, $4,800 per room, which is roughly that same $8 per square foot applied to a representative hotel room size of 600 gross square feet per room. With warehouse and industrial, because those are lower rent, lower cost buildings that are a little bit more sensitive to added costs, we're suggesting considering up to $5 per square foot. And then with respect to retail, we're suggesting that the city consider up to $2 per square foot. And the reason for that lower rate on retail is that as we saw in one of the prior bar charts, that the current fees that apply to retail are already higher than other uses and higher than the other comparisons by a more substantial margin. Retail just has more headwinds with the e-commerce, the rise of e-commerce. So that's the thinking on that lower rate for the retail fee. So I think we can pause for comments and questions now on the if you could focus please on the non-residential to begin with, that would be great. Yeah, I see it. Jay, are you gonna manage the question? I think this is Bill. Can Bill unmute himself? Jay, are you able to allow Bill to unmute himself?
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Okay, I'm glad to see that the city is charging fees, but I'm mystified about the fees that apparently, I don't know if these are proposed or fees are coming in, because I haven't seen one single low-income housing project go up in the city of Goleta. And I've been around this area for 30 years. So I'm concerned that, as you say, only 23% of the employees that work in Goleta live here. That means that 77% of them are commuting as far away as Santa Maria, Lompoc, or Ventura, causing insane amounts of daily pollution. So we don't need any more retail. If you look at Calle Real, I walked down Calle Real the other day, the shopping centers on either side, about 20% of the stores are vacant. The Denny's location has been vacant for 2 years, can't be rented out. The same thing. I walked down State Street the other day in Santa Barbara. About 25% of the storefronts are vacant. So we don't need any more retail construction. We don't need any more hotels. We don't need any more office buildings, any more medical buildings. We have plenty of those. My concern is that the city is allowing these retail, hotel, shopping centers, medical buildings, office buildings to be built, using up all of the land that we might have left for future low-income housing projects. It's becoming a disaster. The businesses in this city can't function because they can't get enough employees to work because they can't afford to live here. It's the same thing in the city. If you can't have your employees afford to live here and they can't afford to drive 30 miles each way to work each day, we're going to be, the businesses are going to be, as is happening, out of luck. They're going to close up. They're going to close shop. It's going to hurt the tax revenue. And that's what's going on. We are long overdue for spending this money that either is coming in or is projected to come in on affordable housing. We need to do it 5-10 years ago, not 5 or 10 years from now. The businesses in this area are going to just die for lack of employees because they can't afford to live here. We need to start these projects now instead of retail, hotel, office buildings, medical buildings. We don't need any more of those. The thing that irks me the most is that the land is being given up to developers like Tobes to develop these really expensive, luxurious apartment and condo complexes that cost over $3,000 a month to rent for a one-bedroom, 800-square-foot apartment. No employee in this working in this town that's not working for the tech industries can afford to pay $3,000 a month. That's $36,000 a year. Service employees that work at hospitals, grocery stores, essential employees, they don't make but $16,000, $18,000 a year. They can't pay twice their income for rent. So this is an urgent problem. I live in a 600 square foot dumpy Tobes apartment on retirement. I spend every penny of my Social Security on rent in this lousy 600 square foot apartment. I pay $2,000 a year for this dump. And that's under the normal rates that they could get. It's a crisis, and we need to get these buildings, these low income buildings, started immediately. Businesses are going broke.
That's really the point on these fees is to start getting a consistent amount of money from new development. Coming in. Your point's very well taken that, as you know, we can bring that up to the decision makers as far as retail goes, that if we're able to charge more, why not, if it would be an actual deterrent, as your point being, we don't really need it anymore, so why incentivize it? That could be a point that's brought up for sure. We do actually have a good number of affordable housing units within the city, and on our annual report every year, it actually has a map, a location map of where they all are and how many units there are. And they're scattered throughout the city. So we do need more, though.
Yeah, we do. At 77% of the employees working in this town having to travel in to work here, that's not good. That's not healthy. It's not economically feasible. It's horrible for the businesses that our tax revenue is going to go down if they can't stay open because they can't get employees to live here. It's insane.
Great,
so
sure.
I appreciate your time, but this is a big problem. We need to deal with it yesterday, not 3 years from now.
Yeah. We've taken those notes down, and we'll move on to Cheryl. But we thank you, Bill.
All right, thank you.
Yep.
Hi, Cheryl Rogers, League of Women Voters. I'm just calling. I'm just asking. Did you say that your recommendation was an average of $8 per square foot? Various types of development.
Not an average, just that rate for non-residential uses other than the other ones that were specifically called out. So $5 for the warehouse and industrial, and up to $2 for the retail, and $8 for everything else.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
And I believe Chuck has his hand raised as well.
Yeah, thank you. I was sort of surprised, maybe a little even shocked, of the disparity in the development fees with Glee in comparison to the rest of the other cities that were shown. I'm just kind of curious if you could unpack that a little bit. It was alluded that other cities may have different fee structures. Mm-hmm. And then the other question I had related to that is, are any of these fees, even Goleta's fees, a disincentive to developers currently or not? I mean, are we seen sort of generally as a high fee city?
I think just to answer the last question first, I think my impression is that Goleta sort of, at least in the feedback in the development community, you are seen as a higher fee city. And that was our reaction in reviewing them, is that they do compare higher than we typically see. In terms of unpacking sort of what drives the fees that we are seeing, and you can find like sort of the breakdown in our report if you care to, but let me walk through it for you a little bit.
Yeah, I apologize, I didn't get a chance to review those, so I will
look at that. Yeah, no problem. But so I'm going to give you an example based on the medical office example, just because I'm looking at it. So the roads transit mobility fee component of the fee really is the main aspect. It's of the total estimated fee of $48 per square foot, exclusive of water and sewer, $41 of that is for roads, transit, and mobility. And then the other components include fire, parks, school district fees, which are charged by the school, obviously, and then public facilities and drainage. And so together, those items represent roughly the other $8 or $9. So it's that transportation fee is kind of a big driver of it. And that's the case with respect to the county as well, with their fee structure. And excuse me, forgive me if I missed part of your question. Did I catch it all?
Yeah, you answered the question specifically. I guess my question is, are we pushing our luck? You know, by adding additional fees, are we kind of killing any prospect of new development? I mean, granted, we want to make sure that we have funding for affordable housing, but we also don't want to be seen as a city that nobody wants to do any kind of new employment opportunities in. Not knowing enough about how fees link to incentives, you know, for or against development, I don't know whether Goleta, from the perspective of overall development costs, these don't seem like high fees. But from the perspective of, you know, our developers saying, well, that's just too much of my profit margin. I'm not, you know, no one's ever going to build in Goleta ever again. Is that what we're looking at or not?
You know,
David, let me answer the first part just really quick. Chuck, we have been requiring payments for policy consistency for non-residential developments, many of them, most of them. And so they have been making payments. So it's been working for them. They've been able to afford it. So I wanted to make sure like that part where this is formalizing and standardizing that what was before a payment into a fee.
Thank you.
And then, yeah.
So there already was the in-lieu fees, and this is just formalizing that process. Thank you.
And I guess, you know, maybe it's not needed, but I would just add that we sort of inquired with developers in our discussions, in our interviews with them, is this a deterrent to you know, we invited sort of them to say, is this a deterrent or not? And you know, it's not certainly not a comprehensive set of interviews that we did, but it is an indicator. And we didn't really get strong feedback in that regard, that it was a huge deterrent. The deterrents that were cited to us really were other aspects rather than the fees. So That was the feedback we got, in addition to the obviously the analysis that we've looked at here.
And Chuck, I think one of the key points that David had mentioned earlier in the lead-in was, you know, at the addition of this fee, the formal process, although it's been being paid, we still have that water issue. And I think, you know, if there is a decline, a lot of these projects that we're seeing throughout the city received their entitlements well before the moratorium and that, you know, that really going into that water crisis. So they've been sitting on and getting time extensions for a number of their projects and then finally pulled the trigger recently. So it makes it appear as though we've recently approved all this development to occur when really it was, you know, years and years ago that those entitlements were received.
Maybe we should move on to the residential. So shifting gears, residential. As with the non-residential, we have a Nexus study, but we also have a series of other pieces of information that will inform fee selection. Let's dive into it. I think the place to start is just a recap of what the inclusionary ordinance requires, which is on the next slide. So as Jay had mentioned, projects two or more units are subject to the ordinance. And for those projects that are subject, they must provide 20% affordable units. And there's a mix of affordable units that are required, and you can see that on the slide on the right-hand side. And there's an explicit policy in the ordinance that favors including those units on site. And in lieu fee payments, as an alternative to including those units on site, is permitted in a few circumstances. And that's when you have a small project, two to four units, and in larger projects, five or more units, where an on-site unit is found to be infeasible by the council, and in lieu fee payment provides equal value to that on-site unit. So that's the standard in the ordinance for an in lieu fee. And that's been somewhat of a guide for us in the analysis in identifying a fee that would be consistent with those characteristics. So if we can go to the next, please. So just as background, these are the incomes that you could have to qualify within these affordable housing categories that we talk about. So median income in Santa Barbara County is $90,000 per year for a family of four. And there's different levels for every household size, but I'm keeping it simple and just talking about four-person households. For a low-income household, if you earn less than $100,000, you would qualify as low-income. And then for above moderate, which is the top end of the categories that are addressed by the inclusionary ordinance, $180,000 per year or less for a family of four. If we could go next, please. And here's some background on the development of residential that's happened in Goleta over the past decade or so. In the early part of the decade, during the Great Recession, there was limited development activity occurring. And then in the subsequent period from 2014 to 2020, there was an average of about 170 new residential units per year built. And of those, roughly 90% were either multifamily apartments or attached townhomes or condominiums, and only about 10% were single family units. And as has been mentioned already, there's this water district moratorium that's probably going to limit development going forward, and at least until that moratorium is lifted when the water goals of the district are met. If we could go next. So just as context for thinking about these affordability categories, we looked at just market rate units and evaluated sort of if you buy something at market rate or you rent something at market rate, what affordability category would that kind of fall in? And so just walking through this one at a time here, existing, when we say existing for sale units, we mean something that's built a while ago and is being resold. About 38% of the sales of existing units would fall into the above moderate category in terms of what income a household could have and be able to afford to purchase that unit. So that's the 120 to 200% AMI level. And then the other 62%, you'd need an income of over 200% of AMI to be able to afford that. And then if you go to newly built units, which typically price for higher than existing units just because they're brand new. If you have money for a 20% down payment, you're able to generally afford a new attached unit. So we mean townhome or condo at 150% of area median income. So that's $135,000 for a family of four is what it kind of takes along with that 20% down payment to afford it. And then if you only have 5% down, which is about the, you know, close to the minimum you can do, you need a higher income to afford the same unit. And that's because you have additional costs there. You have both a higher mortgage payment because you put less money down, and you also have mortgage insurance that you have to pay. And because of those additional costs, you therefore need a higher income to be able to afford that. So roughly, $180,000 a year for a family of four, 200% of AMI is needed for that attached unit. Now, if we shift over to thinking about for sale units, those generally are priced higher. And so in pretty much both cases, you need over 200% of AMI to afford those new for sale single family unit. Rental units, when we talk about an existing rental in a building that's been around for a while, not brand new, an income of about $117,000 to afford market rate rents is what we've estimated is needed. That's 130% of the median for a family of four. And then for newly built rentals, the rent higher, brand new, modern amenities, and you know, the $3,000 a month rents that have been mentioned, 174% of AMI is kind of what you need to afford that level. So both of those, both existing and new rentals, kind of do fall in that above moderate income range is what we're seeing. But somebody who's at moderate or below generally can't without being rent burdened afford that. So we go on to the next, please. For purposes of the analysis that's done, we looked at the development activity that the city has seen and defined these representative project types. Most of the development recently has been either townhomes or apartments, but we also looked at stack flat condos, single family to make sure that we cover that potential development type as well. And the unit sizes and the prices and rents are used kind of throughout the analysis to come up with the conclusions that you'll see. If we could go to the next. So first I'm going to talk about the nexus analysis. The nexus analysis establishes the affordable housing impacts of development and what it costs to mitigate it. It's similar to the non-residential nexus analysis that we talked about in terms of the basic concept. When we add new housing, we're bringing in new households, and there's a demand for retail, healthcare, different services, schools, different services that these households need. And the jobs that are added as a result of providing those services are at a range of income levels, and there's a need for affordable housing. So that's the Nexus study quantifies that and it assigns a cost to addressing that impact. But it's not a requirement. not a requirement for implementing an in-lieu fee, because an in-lieu fee is an alternative to providing the units on site. And, you know, there's been court cases about it. And the bottom line is that you don't need a nexus study to support that in-lieu fee. But we're providing this as sort of an additional point of information regarding the impacts and what it costs to mitigate them. So the conclusions are on the next slide. So $16 a square foot for single family, up to $27 a square foot for apartments is kind of the result of the math that we've done on this nexus analysis. I'll give you a second to look at it, but that was sort of all I have to say on it.
Thanks, Dan. I would just add that one of the reasons that the city, even though that nexus study wasn't a requirement, we really felt that the information, the data that's gathered together and how it's really presented was really useful for not only residents, but ultimately the decision makers to really have that background data and that thought process on how we get to where we were or where we are in presenting these fees. So we thought it useful. As you read through that report or that study, I hope it was worth it. There was a lot of analysis and data crunching in there.
Yeah, I guess I'm sorry, Jay, I'll say one more thing in that we do in fact use the findings in developing our recommendations around the small project. So I won't talk about that too much now, but we use the results. So if we could go on. So now shifting gears to the in-lieu fee analysis. And this is a different analysis in that we're starting with the city's 20% affordable housing requirement. And we're looking at what does it cost to deliver units consistent with that 20% affordable housing requirement. So that's what the in-lieu fee analysis does, as distinguished from the nexus study, which looks at impacts. So here we're looking at baseline is that 20% requirement and what's it cost to meet that. And we give four different metrics for that cost. One is if the developer includes those units on site within their project, what is the cost of that and what does it represent as a dollar per square foot figure? Secondly, we look at delivering those units in a standalone affordable rental development that's financed with the use of low-income housing tax credits available through the state and federal governments. Third, we look at the practice for prior projects and the in-lieu fee that's been applied to prior projects and what that represents on a consistent comparison basis to the other metrics. And then finally, some communities use an approach when they set their in-lieu fee of looking at sales, prior sales, and what those market prices are for those prior sales. And then they compare that to an affordable price for the same unit, and they calculate this affordability gap that's reflected in the market data. So to provide that information to Goleta and what that sort of that approach would represent in terms of a fee based on data for Goleta, we've done that calculation as well. And so the next slide gives you the results of these four calculations. So providing those units on site is the most costly approach. These figures, the 71, the 62, and the 69, these are dollars per square foot within the project. And we're not talking just about the affordable units within the project. We're talking about all the square footage within the entire entire residential component of the development is what those per square foot figures apply to. And the reason they're high is because with the on-site construction, there's generally not an outside subsidy source available to offset that cost. And we're representing like the foregone sales price or foregone rent in effect that the developer experiences in setting that unit aside as affordable. Then Below that is providing units within a standalone affordable project that's receives subsidy sources through low-income housing tax credits. And there we estimate between $12 and $27 a square foot. And because we have that subsidy source available to offset the cost, it reduces reduces the amount substantially. And then below that is the in-lieu fee that's been applied on a case-by-case basis, but it's actually been fairly consistent figure of $80,000 per affordable units that's required. And if you translate that $80,000 per affordable unit required into a per square foot equivalent figure, it results in this 7, 10, and 17. And the reason that apartments are higher is because they're smaller. And so when you spread the same cost over fewer square feet, you get the higher number. And then lastly, it's that approach looking at the gap just reflected in market sales data. And there you get this 29, 40, and 67 per square foot. So if we could move on to the next, please. Next, we looked at past projects in Goleta and looked at how they complied with the inclusionary ordinance. So Village at Los Caneros provided 70 on-site affordable units that were developed by a nonprofit partner, People Self-Help. And the developer, that master developer of that project, donated a site to the nonprofit developer. And there was a value about $700,000 ascribed to that site that was donated. And if you took that $700,000 donated site and express that as a cost per square foot within the development, that the market rate development, it would be this dollar per square foot figure that's referenced at the right-hand side. Then the Winslow project provided 14 on-site affordable units for above moderate and moderate, and then separately paid an in-lieu fee to address the extremely low, very low, and low-income component of their inclusionary requirement. And we have estimated that that would cost roughly $12 per square foot based on their project. And we don't know how much it actually cost. This is our estimate of their cost. Citrus Village Townhomes, they paid an in-lieu fee, and that converts based on their square footages of those townhomes to about $11 a square foot. Haskell's Landing similarly provided a mix of on-site units and fee payment. And we estimate that was about a $6 a square foot cost for them. It's lower than the Winslow project because the units that were provided were generally, the affordable units that were provided were generally smaller in the Haskell's Landing project. So they were able to, we estimate that they were able to reduce the cost of delivering those units somewhat and providing smaller affordable units. And then lastly, these two apartment projects, Hollister Village and Cortona, I think I'm saying that right, they were not subject to the requirement because they came forward prior to the ability to apply rental inclusionary housing to their rental project. That was restored by a change in state law in 2017, but these projects came forward before that change in state law and then the subsequent modification to the inclusionary ordinance. Okay, if we could go to the next slide, please. So this is in-lieu fees in other communities. And they're not all applied on a per square foot basis, but in order to allow you to more easily compare between them, we've converted them all to this per square foot basis. So the higher end in terms of the range that you see out there is City of Santa Barbara and County of Santa Barbara at the kind of $30 to $40 per square foot level. And then Carpinteria and Oxnard are sort of the middle of the range. And then City of San Luis Obispo, Arroyo Grande, and Pismo Beach are towards the lower end of the range of the in-lieu fees that are out there in communities that have inclusionary programs nearby. So this is sort of context for selecting a fee for the city. And then if we could go next, please. So the in-lieu fees we saw previously are for projects that are subject to the ordinance and are generally larger projects. If you are thinking about a smaller four-unit project, which is what this slide is about, most of those jurisdictions don't apply their inclusionary programs to a small four-unit project. They're just exempted based on their size. But the city of Santa Barbara does have a fee that applies. It's the $7 and $9 that you see, and that's quite a bit lower than the standard rate. They reduce it for these small projects. And it's just the standard rate for Arroyo Grande, but they I guess have a lower rate to begin with. So if we could go to the next, please. Now to our recommendations. So with for sale projects, I'm going to go for sale projects first. Based on the analysis you saw and the standard in the ordinance that in lieu fee provide an equal value to putting those units on site, this is our recommendation. So with moderate and above moderate, you've seen projects come forward and include those units on site. We're estimating that to do that represents a cost of $18.60 per square foot, and that the in-lieu fee for that component of the inclusionary requirement be set at approximately that level. And then for extremely low, very low, and low, you saw only one project that included those units on site, and they did so in a low-income housing tax credit financed project. And so we think that the appropriate, given that track record, the appropriate approach in determining the meeting this equal value standard really is the financial gap after low-income housing tax credits for that component. So it's a $9.50 per square foot fee, and it's less than the moderate and above moderate because you have that subsidy source reflected. And that subsidy source isn't available for the moderate and above moderate level. And then, so combined, that's $28 per square foot. So that's a very precise figure. I think it should be taken more as a guide to sort of the magnitude. Certainly don't have to adopt it exactly that number, but that is the number that we calculate this way. And we're suggesting that in lieu fee payment be permitted as a buy right option for extremely low, very low, and low, which is consistent with the treatment and the track record in past projects. But we're suggesting, based on the priorities outlined in the ordinance, that really you continue to restrict the payment of in lieu fees for moderate and above moderate to instances where the findings in the ordinance are made as required. So if we could go on to the next.
Before we do,
yeah.
That project at Village at Los Caneros also received funding from the city from fees that we had collected too. So it was a combination of grant sources as well as, I think Jaime popped in momentarily. He may have wanted to say the same thing, but the city did partner with them in order to get those units provided in cooperation with the developer.
Okay. So this is recommendation for rental developments and the in-lieu fee for rental developments. Again, the recommendations are based on this equal value standard in the ordinance, and $27.40 is our recommendation based on applying that standard and calculating the in-lieu fee based on the gap, financial gap, assuming the assistance of low-income housing tax credits, assuming that those units are delivered with the benefit of that assistance. We also suggest that given the finding that above moderate income units within a market rate development, that market rate developments in effect are affordable to that above moderate income category, that you consider with respect to rental developments only waiving that component of the inclusionary requirement because market rate rentals are delivering units that are affordable to that category. We also suggest that considering, as is consistent with the track record for the projects that you've seen come forward, allowing a mix of units, on-site units and fees, to allow the projects to comply with that mix of on-site units and fees. The fees can be leveraged with other sources to assist all affordable projects and get those built, and then you would still see some units within the project. That's been an option that's been provided to for sale, and we're suggesting that option be maintained. So this would provide some that same flexibility to rental projects. And then we have one more recommendation slide before I turn it back to Jay. So small 2 to 4 unit projects. So these are projects where if I'm a 2-unit project and I'm including a unit on site, gosh, that's 50% of my project. It's sort of not a practical option for these small projects to do that. And the way the ordinance is structured, it's really about payment of a fee for these projects. And because of that, it's important that they have the protection of the Nexus study to make sure that fee is defensible. And so we've recommended that you limit the in lieu fee, the city limit that in lieu fee to a maximum supported by the Nexus study of up to $16 per square foot, and make it a buy right option as it currently is. And then if desired, it could be stepped in with a smaller level for 2-unit projects, and then kind of working your way up to the full in lieu fee for larger projects. So with that, I'm going to turn it back to you, Jay.
Thank you, David. So as we had mentioned before, we did receive our administrative drafts of the fee studies, as well as the accompanying reports. We made those available to the public, and we have received a little bit of feedback, but we welcome as much feedback prior to us taking those forward to our decision makers. If you wanted to provide us feedback to advance planning staff, or if you wanted to show up to the subsequent hearings and provide comments there, they're always welcome. We go quite a distance out of our way to make sure that we involve the public in as much as we can. That's one of the things that the city of Goleta takes a lot of pride in. So those have been available since August 5th. And then obviously today we have our public workshop. Our next step is going before the Planning Commission on September 13th, and that's for a recommendation hearing. So we'll be presenting the studies as well as the reports. We'll be walking through KMA, and David will be giving a similar presentation, an overview of the data and the reports and the recommendations. And we'll also be doing Title 17, our zoning ordinance, will require some amendments as well. So the Planning Commission looks at those recommended amendments to our zoning code, and then makes a recommendation up to the Planning Commission, or up to the City Council, and they will ultimately adopt the amendments to the zoning ordinance, and as well as adopt the formal fees. So Planning Commission is a good time to get comments out and kind of get your input to influence a recommendation vote, and then ultimately the City Council. We're tentatively scheduled in October for the first reading, and then a second reading of the ordinance would occur probably in November. And if there's just those two hearings, October first reading, second reading in November, those zoning code amendments don't go into effect until 30 days after that. So we'll be looking at December and early next year before this program, if everything goes to plan, is set in and fully adopted. And with that, I believe we are ready for questions, comments on our residential. And we'll go with Bill.
Hi, on the chart, maybe I misunderstood it, on the chart where you were showing to rent an existing low income. I think it said you would have to make a family of four would have to make $117,000 or more, or is that the upper limit of what they could make to qualify to rent it? It was a chart showing what you'd have to. The $117,000 was for an existing, and I think it was $170,000 for a new, or something like that. $153,000 for a family. Is that the upper limit of what somebody would have could make?
That's sort of like the estimated minimum that you would have in order to not be facing a rent burden. So, like, there's a standard that's in the health and safety code and is used a lot in affordable housing policy that you shouldn't have rent that's more than 30% of your income. So that's what this 130% AMI is based on. And I'm honestly mixing and matching a little bit, because the typical size apartment is going to be less than three bedrooms in the way you relate family size and bedrooms under the state code is generally a three bedroom would be matched with a four person household. Mm-hmm. And so with that 130% average, it's really probably the average bedroom size is more like 1.5 or 2 bedrooms. And so those income figures don't exactly correspond to sort of the average size.
Yeah, that's my concern. Most essential workers make 20% of that, or 25% per year. So when you're using figures of 117,000 for a family of four, that excludes 77% of your employees that are having to travel out of town. They don't make 117,000. They don't make 75,000. They don't make 50,000. They make between $16,000 and $26,000 a year, maybe $30,000 if they're lucky, maybe if they're astronomically lucky, $40,000. So how are those people going to qualify to buy with 25% down a new unit, or even rent one? Again, all of these figures are right from the get-go excluding the basic problem we have for essential workers. I make, with my Social Security and my dividends and my, I make $32,000 a year. I can't afford to qualify to buy a low-income housing. I'm retired. All of the essential workers in this town that we desperately need are leaving or fleeing because it's costing too much to even rent an affordable housing unit. They don't have $35,000, $40,000 a year to spend on rent. They maybe make $25,000 to $30,000 a year. That has to pay for their rent, their car, their insurance, their gas, their health insurance, everything, groceries, everything else. So that comes, if you make $30,000 a year as an essential worker, you don't have but maybe $12,000 to $15,000 at most a year to spend on rent. So we're talking fantasy times right from the get-go using these numbers.
So I think your point's very well taken, Bill, and I think maybe you probably explained sort of the issue more eloquently than I did in presenting this slide. I think the intent here is to look at what market prices are. Like, if you go out and try to rent something in Goleta, or go out and try and buy something in Goleta, what kind of income would you need to afford that? And I think what you're articulating is sort of what this slide is trying to say, that, gosh, you need incomes that are this high to afford it. And
yeah, that's just not happening.
You're below that, you have a problem, right? That's what you're saying.
Yeah, you've eliminated 77% of the people that are working in Goleta right from the get-go. They can't afford to buy or rent an affordable housing unit in this town at those prices. The only people that can afford to rent these units are the high-tech people that are all living at Willow Springs or arrive at Los Caneros. And I don't know what they're making. I'm assuming they're making $90,000, $120,000 a year. They're the only people that are going to qualify to rent one of these low-income housing units in Goleta.
Well,
the essential workers are not going to qualify.
So this is not what you need to qualify for an affordable unit. This is about the market rate. This is trying to give a perspective on not the affordable, rather the market rate units. So just want to make sure that that's clear. Okay. If we want to go, I think it might be helpful if we go back to that income slide a little earlier that talks about the other categories of affordable, just to make sure that's clear. There we go. So obviously, like extremely low, that's 37,450, very low, 62,450. So these are kind of the categories that if you have the type of income that you were talking about there, Bill, that's where you kind of qualify in. And the inclusionary ordinance does provide for housing at these levels as well.
All right, where do you go to the city to find out when or where these affordable units are available? Because I've been here for 30 years. I've never heard about any list or any available units. I've gone over to some project off of Stork Road that caters to veterans, and they say that is a wait list of 4 or 5 years to get in there. So it's a mystery that if there are any of these units in existing projects that are available, the list is mystical.
Okay, so Bob, as I mentioned before, we have an annual report every year that we present to the Planning Commission and the City Council, and it's a requirement by the state. And that report at the end has a map that shows all the affordable units, where they are located and how many. The city partners with People Self-Help for a lot of these units, but also the county has an agency that really runs, it may be People Self-Help that actually runs all these units and administers them. So there's really, coming to the city, we could point you to this other agency that is actually the one that runs that program.
Okay, but wouldn't it be, with all the newsletters that Goleta sends out every week, wouldn't it be advisable to make the public in Goleta aware of that other agency? I've never heard of that. And I read all of your newsletters. So wouldn't it be advisable to let people know when that list is coming out or who they should go to if they need an affordable housing unit? Because it's all hush-hush as far as I'm concerned. I've never heard about it on the news with all of the homeless problems. I've never heard it on the news. I've never read it in any of your newsletters. It's a secret. It's something that needs to be promoted so people who need this kind of housing know where to go or know what agency to turn to for help.
Hi, I think I can help out on this one. I'm Peter Imhoff. I'm the planning director for the city of Goleta. The planning department has just been restructured in the last year to include a separate affordable housing division. And we are going to be releasing more information. We're in the process now of hiring a dedicated affordable housing analyst who's going to be responsible for this, overseeing this work. And Mr. Ritterbeck is correct that we do work with the County Housing Authority on lottery processes and other processes that involve the selection of qualified tenants for affordable housing that comes online. So we will be doing a better job at outreach going forward, and the comments are well taken. I think you can expect to see more in the future.
Okay, I appreciate that. What was the name of that county agency again?
People, the housing authority of the County of Santa Barbara.
But somebody said something else about the People for Help or the.
And People Self-Help Housing is a nonprofit housing agency that we do work with occasionally on nonprofit projects. So both of those are agencies that do develop affordable housing projects, including in the city of Goleta, but it's really the County Housing Authority that we contract with to run our lottery processes for the selection of, again, qualified tenants, or in the case of owned affordable housing, owners of affordable housing units. And we do maintain an interest list that's updated then in the course of any lottery process.
Okay, well, I have contacted several agencies, and everyone I've contacted says, no, it's a 4 or 5 year wait to get in at any place. That's how bad it is.
It is a long wait. I mean, there are a limited number of new units that are built and that come available. But as they do, we follow a rigorous selection process that's based on a lottery.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Bill. It looks like Charlie has his hand raised as well.
Hello, thank you all for doing this, and thank you, Bill, for those questions. You helped jog some of my memory. Hope you all can hear me. A couple of questions for you, David, about this analysis. The first is, on this particular slide, and maybe I'm misreading this, but it looks like you have the median area median income as 90,000, but then your low is 100,000. So I don't know I'm reading this wrong, but that seems like a possible error on your slide.
Well, I see what you're saying, but these are the income limits that the state publishes.
Interesting.
And where you have a high cost area, like the South Coast, those income limits are adjusted for that fact. And they're adjusted upwards and in part so that recognizing the high cost of housing in that area and the fact that people are spending more to have that housing, that it makes sense then to have people higher up the income scale qualify for it. And so it's true that 50 to 80% of area median income isn't a straight 80% times that 90,000 after those adjustments are made.
If you that makes sense.
Above moderate than they are, but.
And Charlie, I'll add on to that, Charlie. That was one of the things we had noticed that maybe a year or two ago, and we inquired with the state on that. And Santa Barbara County, and I think there's one other county in the state where this is this happens. So normally that adjustment isn't necessary, but there are at least two areas where you will see that little discrepancy.
Very interesting. And this presumably is coming from HUD. These numbers, or this from the state, is separate from how HUD does the income
housing and community development. So HCD and the Office of Planning Research, OPR, two state entities. But HCD is the one that releases these data.
Gotcha. Thank you. That was my first question. Second question was on the Nexus slide where you walk us through that Nexus little arrow. If you mind going to that, distributed back. I was just curious that it sounds like you're saying that making new market rate units is going to increase the number of people, and AKA is going to make, also known as, going to make the housing market worse, which was confusing to me from my basic economics background. So I was curious to see what your elasticity of adding more units, which would presumably increase the supply and driving down the numbers, and then that is adding more people. So I was curious how that is accounted for in your analysis.
I'm not going to argue with the economics component of your question. I think adding supply certainly is important to addressing the housing needs that Goleta has and the whole state has. It certainly does satisfy the housing needs of as we saw in the slide about the affordability of those market rate units. Above moderate households. The purpose of the Nexus study is really to show what impact, what could be supported as an impact fee. And the standard under the law is that you show a reasonable relationship between the impacts of the development and that fee. And so that's the logic that is used in this Nexus study. And so what we do is we look at the needs of those residents of those market rate units and their service needs. And those service needs do result in additional jobs that don't pay adequately to afford that market rate housing. And so that's really what drives the findings of the Nexus study. Certainly appreciate though that not only is affordable housing needed, it's market rate housing is needed too.
I wonder if you could think about a different way of this, which is the land, and especially with this water moratorium, with the water moratorium meaning that the number of developable plots is limited, and land in general is limited, presumably in both these nexus studies, you could do it as a reasonable thing that the housing that is the land that is being taken up, assuming you're not going to build up, which is a different assumption that I think could also be considered. But you're saying that, you know, if you build one big single family home that instead you could have had an apartment complex, the opportunity cost of that land is probably a bigger impact on housing than simply, you know, if you build that warehouse that has cheaper land cost, because that was in your analysis there initially, it's going to be interesting to think about that being a way of considering what should the negative externalities of land use that's not for housing. Could be another concept, an idea for you there, David.
Yeah, I've heard that notion put forward, certainly. I mean, I think there is an argument there, but I think there's, in having explored that previously, it's not as, you know, in my thinking, not as straightforward as a way to demonstrate the nexus as we've done. But I wouldn't argue with you conceptually that obviously there's a trade-off in terms of land use.
It's something that the city could consider in terms of this development, especially if you could have mixed use commercial would be a way of having housing in a commercial development. So just a thought that I had as part of my public comment. So thank you so much for answering my questions.
Thanks, Charlie. I think that you would be really interested in the project that our advanced planning manager is taking forward with the housing element update, where she'll be diving into that specific topic quite a bit more than these fee studies, where they just kind of hint on it a little bit, but that'll be a main discussion that the housing element update will tackle.
Okay, thank you. Thank you for pointing that out.
You're muted, Jay.
Okay, thanks, Andy. So with that, we'll be as I mentioned early on, this entire meeting was recorded. We'll be posting the meeting recording as well as the PowerPoint slide presentation to the city website, which this is the link there. The fee studies, the administrative drafts are still there, available to be downloaded. The nexus analysis or the nexus studies, the full studies, the full reports, past meetings are also links to those meetings, and workshops are also available on that website. So if you are a little late coming to this project, we have archived everything that we've done to date, and you're welcome to contact me as the project manager. My contact information is at the bottom of this slide, and we thank you again for everybody that participated and joined us for this virtual workshop.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.